There are certainly couples who meditate every day, and as we heard earlier, there are wonderful insights into how that deepens their common experience of God and their marital their marital sacredness. But there are also a lot of couples where only one meditates. The other one just doesn't see it, just doesn't feel called into that particular form of contemplative prayer. Do you think a marriage can be can benefit from when only one partner is meditating?
I think so. Because I believe, you know, if only either partner is committed to daily meditation, I think that cannot not rub off on the other partner. So I think that the other partner will sense that his spouse or her spouse, no, has an experience of God which has made her life, filled her or his life with simplicity, with serenity, with a deeper dimension of the meaning of life. I think it will rub off on the other partner sooner or later. He may meet with resistance, and that is the whole, I think, human psychology, no? The resistance. And I think the more I think that either partner who is meditating tries to verbally convince the other, I think, the more resistance I think he or she will have to overcome. So I would not talk about it too much, but do it faithfully, and I think hopefully the vibrations, no, I think the presence of God will ooze out, I hope so, from the one who does his or her meditation.
It's marriage is a very difficult undertaking for many couples today, mm-hmm. many young couples. Mm-hmm. What are the big difficulties, the big challenges that they face, do you think?
Well, I think, no, that I mentioned that earlier, but we are a noisy society. Many people, the first thing in the morning, is switch on the radio or the TV, listen to the stock markets, of course, these days, tremendously, no, but the whole day there is noise around. And, well, that simplicity of the Psalm 46, no, be still and know that I am God. I think we have lost the sense, the taste for God, and that is can only be, I think, be recovered by silence. And society is not conducive at all. People are scared of silence, and I would equate that with scared of God, because only, I think, in silence can we experience and enjoy the presence of God. I came across a text by Henry Newman a few days ago: "Never less alone than when alone." A marvelous text, because then nothing else, no, distracts me. Then God matters, and God fills my whole being.
In the Marriage Encounter program and in the dialogue in the couple, between the couple, that is a very important part of their deepening process and balancing process in their lives. How do you feel that meditation, entering into a silent dialogue, as you said, a dialogue of the soul together, how does that help them to communicate better verbally and psychologically and in other ways?
Well, I would think that meditating, you know, as it were, we let all our conflicts, misunderstandings, our feelings, you know, as it were, we immerse them into the divine reality, and a lot of healing takes place when we are living in God. And afterwards, I believe they will come together, even in a verbal dialogue, coming from within God, and communicate about those things in a more loving, caring way, less aggressive, because healed already by the common experience of dwelling in the same divine reality. So I think they come then together and can really explore and understand and maybe try to find solutions to their problems, no, but coming from within God, not from their own wisdom or their own so-called, no, to human experience. So it boils down, I think, to the same: do we live in God, and do we look at all our problems, family, sexuality, social, political life, no? Do we come from within God, and from within God, no, address and look for solutions? So I think it can make the dialogue much more gentle and loving, than just no talk and dialogue without that experience of contemplation and meditation.
What you're describing is really a sort of conjugal mysticism. Mm-hmm. And in the church, mysticism, the contemplative path, has always been identified really with the celibate life or the solitary life. Mm-hmm. And the married life has been seen as a life of action and life of social and responsibility and parental responsibility. What you're envisioning is a Christian marriage that really does have a mystical dimension in its spirituality, in its prayer, not just in its sacramentality, but in its actual lived daily life. That's something new, isn't it?
But I regret profoundly, you know, that contemplative dimension is not part of all life, of all Christians. I think that is probably the answer to all the problems we are facing in the church of today. That we think that meditation is only for nuns and priests who live the secluded life. Eh? Mm. But I think it should be for all human beings, all believers, I think. What St. Paul says, no, Christ lives in me. That was for all people, not for a select group or a minority of the Catholic Church. I think that is very sad and very regrettable, I believe, that we have, in that way, we have shortchanged our people. That we have seemingly confined contemplation and mystical experience of God to a select group of celibate priests and sisters in the world, and not made it available and train people, initiate people in living in God 24 hours day and night, professional life, married life, family life. We lack, I would say, no, a Catholic family life culture, and that meditation of contemplation could be very much part of it, that as a family too, we heard that from our friends there, no, that they meditate as a couple and that the children at times they join. And I think now yourself are trying now to help young kids, young children, to learn to meditate in silence from early childhood. I believe that is a very important step in promoting Catholic family culture, that people experience God and learn to live in God 24 hours day and night in all that they do. It could be the answer now to make our world a peaceful place. Now it is a violent place.
Thank you. And thank you for your priesthood.
Thank you.
Thank you. Mm.